To begin with, I would like to thank the organizers of the conference for the preparation that they've put into this and also for the opportunity to present my paper here. The topic of my presentation is China, Russia, and Central Asia, complementary or competing interest. And to begin, I wanted to bring up this map of Central Asia, which indicates the location of the five states of Central Asia, which are Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan. And one can see that they are located in between China and Russia. In the last several decades, the ties between China and Russia have steadily grown closer. In a 2019 speech at the Valdai Discussion Club, Russian President Vladimir Putin went so far as to refer to the strategic partnership of the two states as an allied relationship. There is no doubt that China and Russia share largely convergent interests with respect to their perspective on the international political system, where they are united in opposition to what they perceive as the hegemonic West, which is basically to say the United States. At the same time, it is by no means certain that the two states share a common outlook with regard to their foreign policy goals in the newly emergent states in the post-Soviet space. This is especially the case in Central Asia. Russia has a long-standing interest in Central Asia, which was incorporated into the Tsarist Empire in the 19th century and remained under Soviet control in the 20th century. More recently, China has come to pay increasing attention to the states of Central Asia, primarily with respect to its economic activities. China is the relative newcomer to the region, but there is no doubt that its influence is growing. This raises the question as to the extent to which Russia and China share complementary or competing interests in the region. According to the Kremlin, Russia and China are compatible and equal partners in Central Asia, adhering to a division of labor in which Russia is the provider of security guarantees, while China's focus is in the economic realm. Both scholars and policy practitioners largely agree that China's intensified interest in Central Asia has not placed any serious strains on the Sino-Russian relationship. I do not disagree with this assessment, but I do argue that the evidence indicates that Russian and Chinese interest in the region are increasingly divergent and that this is a pattern that is likely to intensify in the future. The main issue is the growing asymmetry in the Sino-Russian relationship with respect to power capabilities. The Chinese GDP is over 6 times higher than that of Russia. Russia increasingly is unable to compete with China, most notably in the economic, but also now in the technological sphere. The organization of my presentation is as follows. I begin by comparing Russian and Chinese activity in Central Asia with respect to institutional structures, economic activity, military and security undertakings, and soft power. Then I turn to evidence of Russian and Chinese efforts to coordinate their foreign policy behavior in Central Asia. And here I look at the Shanghai Cooperation Organization and the 2015 decision to link the Chinese Belt and Road Initiative, or the BRI, with the Russian-dominated Eurasian Economic Union, or the EAEU. The conclusion is an assessment of the extent to which Russian and Chinese interests in Central Asia are complementary or divergent. First, I want to compare the structural institutions that Russia and China are involved with in Central Asia. There are actually numerous institutional links between Russia and the Central Asian states, which are a legacy of the Soviet heritage. But here I confine myself to the major structural organizations. And I want to briefly mention the Commonwealth of Independent States, which was established after the collapse of the Soviet Union, but is pretty much as a purely symbolic function. Then there is the Collective Security Treaty Organization, which counts Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan as its members. This is a military alliance. The Russians often refer to it as a counterpart to NATO, but the fact is that it has never been involved in any real military action. The most recent structural institution is the Eurasian Economic Union. Here, the members are in Central Asia are Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, although Tajikistan has been involved in negotiations to join the EAEU, and Uzbekistan just recently requested observer status. It is modeled after the European Union, and its aim is the free movement of trade, goods, service, capital, and labor among its members. Then the Shanghai Cooperation Organization grew out of the border negotiations between the Soviet Union and China in the 1980s. All of the states of Central Asia, except for Turkmenistan, are members of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And its primary function is as a security organization with an emphasis on battling terrorism. The institutional linkages that connect China to Central Asia are obviously much smaller. There is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. China's a member and, in fact, was originally the initiator of this structure. And then there is the Belt and Road Initiative, which is not, strictly speaking, an institutional organization, but rather a set of economic initiatives orchestrated by the Chinese government. I think it's notable that this organization was announced by Chinese President Xi Jinping during a trip to Kazakhstan in the fall of 2013, which implies that China takes seriously its foreign policy goals in Central Asia. Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan have all signed a memorandum of understanding indicating their official status as members of the BRI. They've also joined the BRI Connected Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, and they all serve as a site for official BRI projects. Turkmenistan has not been involved in any official activities, but has indicated its support of the BRI in bilateral meetings with China. A considerable focus of the BRI in Central Asia, as elsewhere, is on the construction of infrastructure. During the Soviet era, the economies of the states of Central Asia were highly integrated within a centralized planning apparatus. After the collapse of communism, many of these linkages collapsed as well, although Russia maintains close ties with a number of energy projects in the region. In the past 20 years, however, China has eclipsed Russia to become the most important economic actor in the region. This can be seen in tables 1, 2, 3, and 4. Table 1 compares the cumulative foreign direct investment of Russia and China in the states of Central Asia from 2007 to 2019. The data indicate that China has become a larger investor than Russia for every single state in the region, leading to a discrepancy that is probably most noticeable in Kazakhstan on the basis of volume of funds invested, $29 billion versus $6 billion. But actually, the disparity between Chinese and Russian investment ranges from a gap of 4.5 to 1 in Kazakhstan, which is actually the lowest variation in the region, to 41 to 1 in Turkmenistan. In addition to FDI, foreign direct investment, China relies heavily on forms of concessional lending to states in the region, often in conjunction with the BRI. All of the states of Central Asia are in debt to China, as Table 2 indicates, but the situation is more serious in Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Turkmenistan, which have a higher percentage of debt than Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. At 30.5%, moreover, Kyrgyzstan not only has the highest percent of debt to GDP of the five states, but also is in fifth place in a global comparison. Tables 3 and 4 provide additional confirmation of the growth in economic linkages between China and the states of Central Asia. Here we see that in the year 2000, total trade turnover of China and Russia, Russia exceeded that of China for every single state in the region. But Table 4 shows us that 2018 years later, China's total trade with the states of the region exceeded that of Russia for every single state. China's economic interest in Central Asia lie largely in the realm of natural resources and raw materials, which are predominantly located in Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and to a lesser extent, Uzbekistan. At the same time, Central Asia is viewed as a strategic and vital corridor for the transmission of goods from China to Europe within the BRI, which leads to the investment infrastructure projects. For its part, China's exports to Central Asia have come to include items that indicate its rapidly developing technological capabilities. The telecommunications companies Huawei and ZTE have a presence in Central Asia with factories in Uzbekistan, and Central Asia's authoritarian leaders have a considerable interest in borrowing from Chinese experience in utilizing Chinese-manufactured surveillance equipment. Next, I want to turn to a comparison of Chinese and Russian military and security activities in Central Asia. And here, Russia remains indubitably the major security provider in the Central Asian states, but China has notably increased its military and security-related activities in the last few years, to the point where there are emergent signs of competition between them. Russia and China do not coordinate their military and security undertakings in the region except through the framework of joint military exercises conducted by the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Both China and Russia, however, sell arms, conduct military exercises, and train military officers with the states of the region on a bilateral basis. In addition, Russia has two bases in the region. One is an air base at Kant in Kyrgyzstan, and the other is outside of Dushanbe in Tajikistan. China has established what is sometimes referred to as a military base, although it is officially a border station, in the Gorno-Badakhshan autonomous region of Tajikistan, close to the Afghan border. The volume of arms sales to Central Asia on the part of either Russia or China is hard to calculate because both states provide arms to Central Asian states free of charge. Or in the case of China with Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan as a barter for energy. A recent study by Bradley Jardine and Edward Lemon seeks to use a multitude of data sources to calculate arms sale, and they estimate that Russia has supplied over 80% of imported arms to Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan since 1991, with the volume of arms sales increasing over time. On the other hand, Chinese arms sales to Central Asia constituted 1.5% of Central Asian imports between 2010 and 2014, but had increased to 18% for the time period between 2015 to 2019, which is certainly an impressive increase. In this 2014 to 2018 time period, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan purchased more arms from China than Russia in dollar terms. And also, increasingly, Central Asian states are purchasing technologically advanced weaponry from China that Russia is not able to provide. And this includes armed drones, communications technology, and unmanned aerial vehicles. Russia has a far more extensive presence in the area with respect to military training exercises and officer training programs. Russia's presence is greater in both of these areas. And China did not, in fact, initiate military exercises in the region in 2014, but here too, between 2014 and 2019, China undertook 10 bilateral military exercises with Central Asian states. The Chinese military presence is most notable in Tajikistan. In addition to the alleged military base, China has agreed to build border posts for Tajikistan, and here the estimates range between 7 and 11. And in 2016, 10,000 military personnel from China and Tajikistan participated in five-day counterterrorism activities. And also, in an unusual move for China, in 2016, China founded the Quadrilateral Cooperation and Coordination Mechanism, composed of China, Tajikistan, Pakistan, and Afghanistan, that focuses on security and counterterrorist activities in the region. While Russia and China share a common interest in the maintenance of regional stability and the eradication of terrorist activity, there also exist signs of emergent tensions between the two. Or to put it another way, Russia's sensitivities to China's enhanced military and security profile in Central Asia. Possibly in response to China's expanded presence, Russia has increased its security drills and training in Tajikistan since around 2016. And this is of interest because prior to that time, Russia was planning to wind down to a certain extent its military presence in Tajikistan. And it is also recently expanding its presence at the Khan Air Base in Kyrgyzstan and providing new equipment both at Khan and at the military base in Tajikistan. In this point of comparison, I want to examine soft power as a factor of Russian and Chinese influence in Central Asia. And here, while Chinese influence in Central Asia is increasing, there is no doubt that Russia remains a dominant reference point of external orientation in the region. And in this respect, Russia benefits from the Soviet heritage, which, although considerably diminished, continues to exercise an impact on the area. And this is seen in a number of dimensions. I just want to note the continued importance of the Russian language, which is a form of communication between Central Asian groups as well, most notable in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. The prevalence of Russian language media, which is superior to local media, and television especially, is widely viewed. In this sense, Russian language media is least available in Turkmenistan. There is also the continued linkage between Russian and Central Asian political elites and business interests, and the importance of remittances that come into the region as a source of GDP in Kazakhstan, where it is 28.5%, Tajikistan 28.6%, and Uzbekistan 14.8%. And these remittances are actually diminished compared with 5 years ago, but they still are important. In comparison to Russia, the historical, cultural, and social ties that connect China to Central Asia are far more limited, but both states have developed a program of government activities that seek to promote a positive image in the region, and these are, on the Chinese side, the Confucius Centers, and on the Russian side, the Ruzhsky Mir Centers, the Ruzhsky Mir Cabinets, and Centers of Science and Culture, which are an inheritance, a sort of inheritance from the Soviet era. The actual function of these organizations is quite similar in the sense that they seek to teach the Russian or the Chinese language and inculcate a sense of Chinese or Russian culture in a positive way. We see that there are 13 Confucius Institutes, 9 Ruzhsky Mir, 7 Ruzhsky Mir Cabinets, and 6 Centers of Science and Culture. that span the region, except for Turkmenistan, which doesn't have any of these. It's also the case that the Chinese widely subsidized Chinese language learning through the Confucius Institutes in Central Asia, such that, for example, 3,000 students are reported to be studying Chinese at the Confucius Institute at Tajik National University alone. And the number of Confucius Institutes and classes per capita are greater in Central Asian countries than anywhere else in the world. Table 6 notes the existence of branch campuses of Russian institutions of higher education in Central Asia, which of course teach in Russian, and there are 20 of these in every state of the region except for Uzbekistan. Table 7 notes the number of students from Central Asia enrolled in Russian institutions of higher education. And we see, I think also it's a significant situation, that the number of students has not decreased over time, but increased significantly from 2000 to 2001. And that thousands of students from the region continue to study in Russia. Table 8 provides information, not very satisfactory information, I'm afraid, of the number of students from Central Asia enrolled in Chinese institutions of higher education. These are approximations because of COVID-19, the library is closed. And I haven't been able to go to the library to access the Chinese statistical yearbooks that would provide sort of systematic information about this, and could also provide for some information over time, which would be useful. What one does see, though, is that there are a number of students studying from the Central Asian states in China, and there is scattered evidence to indicate that these numbers have increased greatly over time. For example, from 1993 to 2005, only 265 students from Tajikistan studied in Chinese universities, compared with approximately 3,000 in 2019. So, in conclusion, Russia remains the most important location for tertiary education for Central Asian students. And China is not as popular as Russia, but it is also an increasingly attractive location for Central Asian students who also benefit from Chinese scholarships. It's not easy to assess the extent to which either Russia or China is able to make use of soft power strategies as a means of attraction. There are negative attitudes toward Russia and China, both in Central Asia. For Russia, it is the resentment toward Russia as the former imperialist overlord and oppressor. But for China, there's no real historical legacy to speak of, but there are fears of economic subordination to a powerful neighbor. This is especially the case in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, where there have been a protest against the Chinese presence. And throughout the region, there's also unease and hostility regarding China's policies toward Muslims in nearby Xinjiang province. Although the main target of Chinese efforts at political suppression have been members of the Uyghur ethnicity in Xinjiang province, Chinese Kazakhs and Kyrgyz have also been detained or placed under surveillance in the so-called re-education camps. Nonetheless, the limited evidence suggests that Central Asian citizens are generally reasonably well disposed toward both Russia and China. Russia has received a considerable negative publicity regarding the way it treats migrant workers, especially from Central Asia. But a study by Gerber and Zaviska noted that the Kyrgyz labor migrants that they interviewed were actually quite well disposed toward Russia and were grateful for the opportunity to earn income, and had a generally positive view of Russia as a consequence. And also a recent study by Marlene Laurel and Dylan Thomas surveyed citizen attitudes toward Russia, Chinese, and the United States in Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, and Uzbekistan. And here we see that Russia is perceived more favorably than China, but China is generally received reasonably favorably in the region, less so in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. And rather interestingly, hard to know what to make of this data, respondents in Turkmenistan had by far the highest ratings of strongly favorable toward Russia, and also, although to a lesser extent, strongly favorable toward China. Next, I want to turn to the topic of Central Asia as a factor in the Sino-Russian bilateral relationship. And here, despite their close ties, Sino-Russian relations are not characterized by a coordination of their foreign policy behavior. Rather, the two states continuously stress their convergent as compared to synchronized interests, which is largely in the international system. If we confine ourselves to looking at Sino-Russian relations in Central Asia, we see two organizations in which they interact. One is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and the other is the EAEU BRI. Although note that this does not involve all of the states of the region, doesn't involve Turkmenistan, and with the EAEU BRI coordination, it only involves Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. But basically, China and Russia have divergent interests in the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Initially, China sought to reorient the Shanghai Cooperation Organization toward an economic focus, including the conclusion of a free trade agreement between the SCO and China. They failed due to Russian and Central Asian resistance, and after this, China moved toward the promotion of the Belt and Road Initiative, which some analysts speculate was a consequence of their failures to restructure the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Since then, China has more or less left the SCO to Russian orchestrations. They opposed, although not officially, the 2017 entrance of India and Pakistan into the organization. It's a similar kind of story about the coordination agreement between the EAEU and the BRI. When China first announced the BRI in 2013, the Kremlin reacted with suspicion regarding China's potential intentions to penetrate what Russia perceived of as their sphere of influence in the post-Soviet space. And they also initially declined China's invitation to join the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. Later, it appeared that they realized that they had few options, and so they chose to embrace the project. But despite all of the positive rhetoric that comes out, there's no evidence to suggest any successful implementation of this coordination agreement, which is to say that all of the 40 projects that the EAEU submitted to China have been rejected by China, and China's projects regarding the BRI in Central Asia are conducted entirely on a bilateral basis. Notably, Russia's possibly growing frustration with the agreement is hinted at by the absence of Russian Minister of Foreign Affairs Sergei Lavrov at a July 2020 virtual BRI conference. In this last section of the presentation, I want to assess Chinese and Russian interest in Central Asia, and I want to stress that China and Russia do share important overlapping interest in Central Asia, Both states are concerned with the threat of terrorism in the region, emanating primarily from Afghanistan, but also especially in the Chinese view by separatist activities in Xinjiang province. They also share an interrelated antipathy to the prospect of political instability and also the attendant possibility that a meddling West, also a source of joint antagonism, could institute a pro-democracy movement and a color revolution scenario that could bring about regime change. These issues are also by and large worrisome to the regional elites, who nonetheless tend to be more open to the prospect of cooperative interchanges with Western states. The Russian perspective on Central Asia, however, is indelibly shaped by the view that the region constitutes what former Russian President Dmitry Medvedev called a sphere of privileged interest. From this perspective, the economic penetration of China into the area is inherently an intrusion, but it is one that the Kremlin has been largely powerless to prevent. The Russian response has been to construct a narrative that in itself delineates spheres of influence that simultaneously portray Russia and China as equal partners in the venture. This narrative is challenged not only by China's economic dominance, but its increasing entry into the military and the security realm. China's expanded operations in Tajikistan appear to be an indication of its concern over the fragility of the Afghani government and its ability to control a variety of lethal political movements. But at the same time, it seems to imply that the Chinese leadership also has little faith in whether or not the Russians can perform as security providers there. China's increased economic dynamism in the region, however, has a variety of spillover effects that further threaten Russia's goal to exert influence. It appears probable that China will seek to increase its security-related activities with its expanded presence economically and the further development of its BRI initiatives. China's technological prowess further diminishes the appeal of Russian exports, and the trade and linkages that are being developed redirect transport in the region through Central Asia rather than Russia. Russia has a significant advantage over China on the soft power dimension, but China's significant investment in Confucius Institutes and the lure of scholarships to study in China also have strategic implications as to the prospect that these measures could further reorient Central Asia away from Russia toward China. What will the future bring? Assessments of the Russian-Chinese relationship in Central Asia have often not recognized sufficiently the rapidity of the growth of Chinese influence in the region. A central point of my presentation is that the Chinese penetration into Central Asia has largely taken place in the past 20 years, and that this trend has accelerated in the past 10 years. 20 years ago, for example, Chinese trade lagged well behind that of Russia, but the situation is now reversed. We also see some other significant developments which have been pointed out or alluded to previously in my presentation. One is that China did not provide any foreign direct investment to Kyrgyzstan until 2011, but now Kyrgyzstan is increasingly linked to and integrated into the Chinese economy. Chinese arms sales have increased to the region. We see that Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan bought more arms from 2014 to 2018 from China than from Russia, and the percentage increase has jumped considerably in a nine-year period. Similarly, China's first bilateral military exercise in the region was 2014, but until 2019, they had conducted 10 exercises in the region. And we also see the large-scale investment that China is is making in Confucius Institutes and Chinese language classes, such that per capita their efforts are greater than ever anywhere else in the world. And on this note, I would like to conclude that it is difficult to predict the future, but if current trends continue, the Chinese presence in the region seems likely increasingly to put strains on the Russian-Chinese relationship. Thank you very much for your attention. I appreciate the opportunity to present this talk, and I welcome any questions or comments, and my email address is detailed below.